thank you all so much for coming. This is, I think, the beginning in many ways of a lot of interesting work, research, and some of it activism over the next few years. This particular teaching is dedicated to the issue of banning the bomb, particularly here in 2017, where this month the United Nations is convening negotiations on an international treaty to ban nuclear weapons worldwide. And it was a resolution that was supported by 123 countries. So it's happening, as Zia will tell you more about. It's a controversial process, but we think there's a lot of room for debate and discussion, and particularly since it's happening in our own backyard, it's a good chance to open up some of these conversations here at Princeton. So, by way of introduction, my name is Tamara Patton. I'm a second-year PhD student in the Woodrow Wilson School. In Science, Technology, and Environmental Policy program, I focus on nuclear arms control issues and treaty verification systems more broadly. And I'm joined today by Dr. Zia Mian, who is the co-director of the Program on Science and Global Security, and who has been working as an, can I say, anti-nuclear activist for about 35 years. So he's certainly been around the block on these issues. And basically, the way the teaching is going to work is we're going to start off with a short clip of some moments, both past and present, to kind of hold in our minds as we talk about some of the different themes in this session. And then Zia is going to talk about the ban treaty process, kind of how it evolved and how we got to where we are today. And then since it's a particularly contentious issue here in the U.S., she's going to give some background on the U.S. position on whether to participate or not and what participating might mean. And then we'll turn back to me to do some final remarks and open it up for discussion. So to start, we're going to do this short clip, if I can get it to work. It's a hodgepodge, but rather than showing a bunch of different videos throughout the session, we're just going to show them all at once. So just try to hold them in your mind. I don't have sound, so I'm going as loud as I can here.
Into just such a race, President-elect Donald Trump. Mr. Trump was seeking to clarify, we think, a statement he made less than 24 hours ago. The United States must greatly strengthen and expand its nuclear capability until such a time as the world comes to its senses regarding nukes.
The wonderful agreement would be that no country would have nukes. But if countries are going to have nukes, we're going to be at the top of the pack.
And that brings us to the main reason why so little is being done to reduce the number of nuclear warheads. Deep down, people just don't give enough of a shit anymore. In the 1980s, hundreds of thousands of people pushed for disarmament in Central Park. But in May of this year, this is what a House hearing on nuclear security looked like.
We should point out probably one of the few hearings in which actually the attendance of the subcommittee compares very favorably with the attendance of the audience. Because the public has not tuned into these issues as they should.
That's right. A hearing on the most dangerous things on Earth had attendance rivaling that of a weekday open mic poetry slam.
With that, I will turn it over to
Zia. Yeah, thank you, Tamara. So the plan for the first part of my comments is to just walk you through the awkward and deeply contested and often contradictory policy that the United Nations and some elements of the international community have had with regard to the challenge of the elimination of nuclear weapons. But let me start by showing you, for those who don't know, a sense of the scale of where we are today. So, this is the current estimates of who has how many nuclear weapons in the world. And when you ask most people, either at Princeton or in the country, who has nuclear weapons and how many they have, the first thing you realize is that there is a profound lack of knowledge about the basic scale of the nuclear threat today in terms of how many thousands of nuclear weapons there are actually in the world, how ready they are to launch in some countries, and how the nuclear weapons have spread to 9 countries. But so if you add it all up, it comes to about 14,000 nuclear weapons worldwide. This is much smaller than it was back in the middle of the Cold War, but the scale of reduction of nuclear weapons over time since the end of the Cold War has reduced dramatically. Each arms control agreement between the United States and Russia since the end of the Cold War has made a smaller and smaller actual cut in the number of deployed nuclear weapons that they actually have. Many of these weapons have moved from being deployed to being put in a queue for dismantlement, and that queue for dismantlement means that it's so large that it will take years and years to actually dismantle those, and there are still thousands still actually ready to use. So if we move to the next slide, the need to abolish nuclear weapons has been recognized from their inception. So one of the most important decisions the United Nations ever took was its very first decision. Resolution 1 of the United Nations, January 1946, the first time they actually met and discussed and agreed on anything after the founding of the United Nations, was the resolution calling for a plan for the elimination of nuclear weapons and other weapons of mass destruction. This is the oldest resolution the United Nations has passed and remains unfulfilled. There is, as yet, no plan for the elimination of nuclear weapons. But, inspired by this resolution that was passed, both the United States and the Soviet Union in 1946 suggested ideas for the elimination of nuclear weapons. And because of the Cold War, none of those was fulfilled. As we saw with the speech from President Kennedy, by the early 1960s, the growth of nuclear weapons and the coming especially of hydrogen bombs, thermonuclear weapons, meant that there was a profound sense of global insecurity and the nuclear danger that far exceeded what had happened with Hiroshima. So in 1961, in November 1961, the General Assembly of the United Nations revisited the question of nuclear weapons and made a really important statement. So Tamara, the statement is missing.
For some reason, it's not showing. I'm so sorry.
Okay, so what they declared in this resolution in 1961 was that the use of nuclear weapons would be a violation of the Charter of the United Nations and a crime against humanity and a crime against civilization. Right? This was overwhelmingly passed by the General Assembly. And so as a consequence, what we've had ever since then is a clear statement from the international community that the threat of use of nuclear weapons and the actual use of nuclear weapons is seen to be a profound violation of fundamental norms and understandings of the international community. That perspective, however, faded into the background in the 1960s and 1970s, and it came back in the early 1980s with the nuclear freeze movement because of the resumption of the Cold War in an intense fashion by Ronald Reagan and the United States, and Margaret Thatcher in Britain with the movement of new generation of missiles to Western Europe, and the threat of imminent nuclear war mobilized millions of people across Europe and the United States to protest and call for an end to the arms race and the abolition of nuclear weapons. But with the end of the Cold War, that sense also has faded, the imminent threat of nuclear weapons. What did happen at the end of the Cold War was, though, that in 1996, the International Court of Justice, which is the highest court of the United Nations system, was asked by the United Nations to pass an advisory opinion on the legality of nuclear weapons. And the court ruled in its advisory opinion that the use of nuclear weapons would almost inevitably be inconsistent with international humanitarian law as it exists today, and that there was an obligation among the nuclear weapon states to negotiate the abolition of nuclear weapons. So, but there is nothing that actually exists in international law that mandates those negotiations. And so what we've seen in the last few years is an effort by non-nuclear weapon states to put pressure on the weapon states to begin a process for closing this legal loophole of actually having a treaty that banned nuclear weapons in the same way that there's a treaty that bans chemical weapons and a treaty that bans biological weapons. And one of the things that's been driving this agenda forward is a growing realization of the planetary scale consequences of nuclear war. And so recent scientific studies have tried to use modern climate change models to try and understand what happens if there would be even a limited nuclear war, for example, between Pakistan and India. And this shows the spread of the smoke and the dust from burning cities as it covers the planet over a period of a few weeks. And as it, the smoke and the soot would reduce the amount of sunlight that reaches the ground, and it would have enormous consequences for the production of food and for other ecosystems, as well as catastrophic loss of ozone and the other kinds of systems that we depend on for maintaining modern life as we know it on the surface. So this calculation, which is done by colleagues up at Rutgers and elsewhere, has played an important role once upon a time in the 1980s, when the idea of nuclear winter was first advanced, but has been brought back to the fore by using modern climate change models to try and understand these consequences. What the models now show is that the effects of nuclear winter would last of the order of a decade in terms of fundamentally disrupting growing seasons for food across most of the world. There would be catastrophic famine if that were to pass. And so the new dialogue about nuclear weapons that has started to emerge has been to move away from ideas of thinking about nuclear weapons in terms of national security and national defense to ideas of nuclear weapons as a humanitarian threat to the planet as a whole. So, next slide. And so, as Tamara mentioned, what we had was a UN resolution that was passed overwhelmingly with 123 countries in favor, calling for multilateral nuclear disarmament negotiations to begin. So this was passed last year, and those negotiations are beginning later this month in New York. And this will be an epical moment in the history of the nuclear age. This is the first time since the existence of nuclear weapons that there will actually be international negotiations for a treaty to ban permanently nuclear weapons. Right? We've been waiting for this since 1946. Okay, next slide. The United States' reaction to this effort has been to try and prevent this resolution being passed. And At the time of the vote in the United Nations, at the end of last year, calling for the beginning of negotiations, the United Nations circulated a classified document to its NATO allies, which the United States protects with its nuclear weapons, urging them strongly to vote no against an international treaty to ban nuclear weapons. You have to remember, Obama was still president. Even though he had said in his speech that the United States seeks a world without nuclear weapons, when the opportunity came for a treaty to ban nuclear weapons, the United States told its clients, you have to vote no. One reason the United States felt obliged to tell its clients to vote no is that in some of these countries, there is public pressure, including from their parliaments, to be part of the ban treaty negotiation process and support the elimination of nuclear weapons. The United States, in some cases, is trying to compel its client states in Europe and East Asia to support the U.S. retention of nuclear weapons, even though people in some of those countries don't want to be protected by American nuclear weapons and seek the elimination of nuclear weapons everywhere. Under the Trump administration, we actually expect this problem to get worse in some regards, because the U.S. attitude towards the United Nations has become much more belligerent. And the statement from the Trump's new ambassador to the United Nations that if you don't stand with the United States now, we're taking names. In other words, you will pay a consequence for not supporting us in the United Nations. So we'll see how this plays out in the nuclear negotiations going forward. But we are certainly at an epochal moment where the vast majority of the world's countries are on one side of this issue, and the nuclear weapon states, which are a handful of states, are on the other side. And just to end my remarks, if the United States were to take part, it would be very hard for its nuclear allies, Britain and France, also not to take part. The Chinese and the Indians actually came to the first organizing session for the negotiations that took place in February. And so that would only leave Israel, Pakistan, India, and North Korea as the outliers from this kind of process, right? So we actually have the capacity to pass a treaty that would ban nuclear weapons and then mobilize international opinion to deal with those few states that seek to remain outside the system. So, Tamara.
So hard to follow. So before we move into discussion, I just wanted to briefly come back to this issue you touched on about awareness about nuclear weapon policy issues more broadly, and particularly in academia, where you know, we have these discussions in our classrooms, in our seminars, and I think it's worth talking about you know, how we're treating this issue as a university and as a community. And an eye-opening experience for me in particular was in the lead-up to these negotiations. We've been trying to raise awareness on campus and putting out information for students and a petition and a pledge. And many, many students, you know, who were interested in the issue said, you know, I can't sign this issue because I just don't know enough about it. I don't know the debate well enough. Which is a fair position, but it's also a question of you know, how can we change that when something this historic is happening again right in our own backyard. So you have this handout, which is it's not a complete list of examples of nuclear incidents, accidents, and times we very nearly came to a full-scale nuclear war, but it gives you a good sort of sample. The reason you're holding this in the context of this teaching is that I think one of the primary arguments against the ban treaty, and especially one that comes up a lot in our classrooms, is the debate over nuclear deterrence, and you know, that this notion that it's integral to maintaining international security and international stability. And it's a fairly widely accepted view in the United States in particular, and I think students in our generation, they have a tendency to either accept this view or treat it with indifference, despite the fact that incidents like these, you'll see it starts in the 60s but goes all the way up until, you know, a few years ago, are still taking place. And directly, are still directly threatening each of us. Just to very briefly highlight some of the reasons for this, again, we don't have a lot of time, but I think part of it is about the way that nuclear issues are taught in many IR and political science courses, with these very neatly packaged theories that don't take into full account things like mechanical and human error that we've seen numerous times over the course of history. Things like, because of the lack of education and awareness in our mainstream media, which tends to focus disproportionately on cases like Iran and North Korea, without turning equal scrutiny onto the actions and some of the systematic failures within our own government. And I think a telling example of this is the way that major media outlets in the US, like the New York Times, Washington Post, none of them covered the UN resolution on the ban treaty. It's like it never happened. There was just nothing. I think lastly, because part of it is just that many of us did not grow up during the height of the Cold War. So we didn't have any Ducker cover exercises or, you know, fallout shelter drills to make that immediacy and that connection to the threat much more real in our everyday lives. So public perception and awareness, yeah, what you mean? Thanks. Actually, the next one. I think we know it's very different today than it was, as you talked about and as John Oliver pointed out, that in the 1980s, the streets of New York were flooded over this issue, with the public and students, you know, demanding nuclear disarmament. And I think it's important for us to realize that even though we've reduced the numbers, we have not in any way resolved the issue of nuclear risk. And in some ways, that risk is even increasing, as you'll see in some of the examples that talk about cyber vulnerabilities and the increasing weight that that plays in this issue. So I think we're at this really critical juncture where we have, in a teach-in later this afternoon, which I really encourage you to come to, by Bruce Blair, Frank von Hippel, and Zia Mian, on the nuclear doomsday machine, or doomsday, basically talking about Trump and a lot of the, you know, the risk inherent in the next 4 years. So we have that. We have a president who's talking very cavalierly about things like entering a new nuclear arms race. But at the same time, we have this ban treaty movement happening, you know, an hour away from our campus. And so it's a really interesting ecosystem for us in particular here at Princeton to think about how we're going to engage with this issue and how we're going to try to achieve progress, or at least open discussion. So I think last slide, please. I want to leave some time for discussion, but just for those of you who are interested in engaging more on this issue, the easiest thing to do is put your email on that clipboard that's been going around. We'll send you kind of a package of just one email that contains, you know, some key information and dates about the negotiations, and ways that you can, you know, act in ways big and small if you're interested. One of them is simply writing to your representatives. There's an easy link on nuclearban.org where you can send a message to your UN ambassador. A few people in the room I know have done it and have actually gotten a reply from the office. So, I mean, it does get on their radar. There's also another one for US citizens where you can write to your senators or your representatives to encourage them to support the US participation in the movement. Coming up when the negotiations actually start, we're going to be having a Twitter campaign where we're basically going to be encouraging the mainstream media to be covering this issue by tagging them with this hashtag nuclear ban is news, and hoping that, you know, we can at least bring some transparency to the issue. There's also going to be a march in June 18th in New York. I don't remember the route at the moment, but it's on this page. Again, it's another way, easy way to show up on this issue. And lastly, we are initiating a student organization and network of organizations, in fact, that where we will be working to raise awareness on campus through large and small events, through writing articles, and through working with other chapters and other universities. So again, if you're interested in joining that in any way, again, big or small, that will also be an option. So with that, yeah, I think we can open it up to any questions that you may have about the negotiations, country positions. If you think there's something on this list that we should be doing that we aren't, or you know, discussions that we should be having that we aren't, again, all ideas are very welcome.
Tamara, can you tell us a few words about this first stage of the negotiations? What will be happening in March in comparison to the next stage in June? Like, how important this first 5 days of the conference will be? What's really this about?
Yeah, so I've been working with some of the people who have been involved in setting up the Ban Treaty negotiation process as a civil society from around the world. I'm working with the governments that are actually going to be responsible for the negotiations. And one of the things that is very important about the Ban Treaty negotiations is that the UN resolution establishing the negotiations actually says, for one of the very rare times in the history of international negotiation, that civil society has the right to participate. Not just to be an observer, which is what usually happens, that we get to sit in the back while the diplomats claiming to represent people who usually were never asked about their government's position on these things negotiate. But this time, the UN General Assembly actually said that civil society has the right to participate. So what's going to happen in the first set of negotiations later this month is that countries will begin to agree a basic outline for a draft for a treaty to ban nuclear weapons. And the goal is that countries will come with ideas for what should be in different elements. What exactly is it to be banned? Right? Are we going to ban the possession of nuclear weapons? Are we going to ban the stockpiling of nuclear weapons? Are we going to ban research of some kinds on nuclear weapons? How are we going to deal with the fact that the United States, alone among the nuclear weapon states, actually put some of its nuclear weapons in other countries? So those weapons don't belong to the Netherlands or Italy or Germany or Turkey and so on, but they belong to the United States, but they're in those countries. So what happens to those weapons under that treaty? What happens to those countries? And so there's a whole series of issues that negotiators will work through with input from civil society groups from around the world on what exactly is it that needs to be banned and their justifications for those bans. So the first set of negotiations will seek to try and achieve agreement on the basic elements of what needs specifically to be banned and what the rules for such a treaty might be in terms of that if you join, should you have given up your nuclear weapons before joining, if you're a nuclear weapons state and want to join, or can you sign and join and then agree a process over time to eliminate the weapons that you have? So that's how it works in the Chemical Weapons Treaty, that you can join even though you have chemical weapons, but part of the treaty is that you commit to eliminate your weapons and you have to submit a program for how you're going to do it over a particular amount of time. So, you know, these are the things that countries are going to have to decide. That the states want nuclear weapon states to try and join the treaty because that's the whole goal, to eliminate nuclear weapons. And one of the questions will be, how do we deal with a state that has nuclear weapons that actually wants to join? So that's going to be the goal of the first part. And the goal of the second part will then be to try and reach final agreement on some of these issues that may become contentious and reach the broadest possible agreement and perhaps actually have a treaty by the end of the year that would eliminate nuclear weapons. But there was a question there?
Yeah. When you talk about sort of the food shortage that might result as a sort of a crime against humanity, even that seems to be like it shifts the discourse on nuclear weapons from something that is more geopolitical to environmental crisis. And I was even that shift. My question is that how is it currently taught this sort of overall discourse on nuclear weapons, and what do you think are sort of lacking in the way it's taught now, and how do you sort of do you have any ideas about how it could be better taught in courses where it is more multidisciplinary in its approach?
So we can do this two ways. I mean, Tamara can talk about her experience of actually taking courses on nuclear weapons and how she has seen this being taught. So do you want to talk about that first, and then I'll talk about how I try and teach it. And that might give you some idea of how we've thought about this.
So I started in this issue as in my second year of undergrad, basically. And my undergraduate university luckily had a program that actually specialized in nuclear weapon policy. So I kind of have gotten to see a full spectrum in some ways of what it looks like at, you know, at least in one institution, and undergraduate level and master's degree level, and I'm here now in the PhD program. There's a broad range, but like I said, I think because the issue is so complex, there's a lot of oversimplification, I think, that happens in trying to convey the main literature of the field. And especially when you blend that with, you know, the IR theory and the political science theory of, you know, realism, liberalism, and you get this notion as you're taking these courses that, you know, nuclear deterrence is, it's inevitable, you know, it's an impossible problem, and this is the way, you know, it has been since the 40s, and this is the way it always has to be. And that there isn't, at least in most of the courses I've taken, there hasn't been space for talking about alternatives. So, you know, you can get into this very, very circular debate about does nuclear deterrence work or does it not, and it gets into this very counterfactual, you know, based arguments. And the discussion so far has never turned, I shouldn't say never, because there are courses that do bring up the environmental issue as a part of the bigger picture. But in terms of framing it not as, you know, does nuclear deterrence work or does it not work, but can we do better? You know, can we think of a model of a foundation for international security that is better than nuclear deterrence? Can we evolve beyond it? And that's a discussion that I think is more rare in the courses, and bringing into the motivation in terms of the environmental factors, in terms of, you know, the humanitarian element, you know, outside destroying the planet, actually, you know, seeing these weapons as weapons of genocide. And I think that's a term, even the term genocide, that doesn't even come into most of the foundational courses in the field. So I think part of it is, you know, bringing in a bigger diversity of issues, and also thinking about our language and how, you know, we've been trained to talk about these ways, this issue in ways that constrain our thinking.
So let me just follow up from what Tamara said there. One of the most famous articles on this question of nuclear weapons and who has them and why is written by a political scientist from Stanford called Scott Sagan. And it's called Three Models in Search of a Bomb. And it tries to explain why is it that countries seek nuclear weapons. And it does it in this way of trying to explain the security dilemmas that countries face, or the role of bureaucratic politics in those countries, or issues of power and prestige in the international system. And it all looks really compelling and convincing until you step to one side and ask, well, all countries have security dilemmas. All countries have bureaucratic politics. All countries have some degree of nationalist politics and issues of prestige with regard to their neighbors and allies and others, historically or in the present. So why don't all of them have nuclear weapons? Why is it that only 9 countries have actually chosen to make nuclear weapons? South Africa made them and gave them up. So what I'm getting at with this example is that most of the political science literature on nuclear weapons, especially that taught in the United States, normalizes the idea of having nuclear weapons by embedding it in these processes that are universal, but without raising the question that if these are actually such universal processes, why don't they apply to the vast majority of countries? Because the fact of the matter is that there are 193 countries in the international system right now, and a lot more of them by any of the measures that I use to explain why the United States and a few other countries have nuclear weapons should also apply to them at some stage in their history. But they didn't. But there's no similar literature on, well, what are the universal principles and processes that led the vast majority of countries to reject having nuclear weapons and to actually end up supporting a treaty to ban nuclear weapons, right? Nor does this literature embrace the question of why is it that almost from the beginning, the United Nations system, as I said, in 1946, January, Resolution 1, called for the elimination of nuclear weapons. This was such an obvious answer to having national security, build nuclear weapons. Why did we ever go down the idea of having a ban? And then you saw President Kennedy saying, oh, you know, the whole world is in danger, we need to ban nuclear weapons. So how do you explain that? Or Obama, how do you explain that? Either is it cynical politics, or is it the fact that there is actually a profound contradiction that occasionally statesmen struggle with, you know, political leaders struggle with, to try and deal with this, and are frequently overwhelmed by political processes in their countries that stop them from actually acting on the rationalization and realizations that they've reached about nuclear weapons. So when I teach this material in the course that I teach on nuclear weapons here, I focus on that. Nuclear weapon states and the people who argue for nuclear weapon states and nuclear weapons institutions are held out as aberrations requiring explanation in specifics rather than examples of universal processes that seem to apply everywhere. They are the exceptions to bureaucracy and how states think in the world, not explicable by universal principles because they are weird and odd and stand out. So I think that's how one begins. What's normal and what's a band? Yeah, question right there?
Yeah, I'm not an international relations person, I'm a physicist, so forgive my ignorance for any of this, but I mean, what happens if at the end of the day, all the countries that don't have nuclear weapons vote in favor and all the ones that do vote against? What are the practical consequences of such a treaty?
Well, we're basically where we are. Right? Right now, you have the nuclear weapon states having nuclear weapons,
right?
The nine of them, and everybody else doesn't have.
Well, except now that there's a treaty saying you shouldn't.
Right. But so the goal, right, of this process is to fill the legal gap in the international system, right, that says there is no ban on nuclear weapons. To say yes, there is. As far as the international community is concerned, overwhelmingly and massively, there is a ban. Then your question becomes the same as what do decent people do when they live among murderers? Right? I mean, just having a law about murder doesn't stop all murders.
It's a moral argument that puts the United States in the same position as other countries that are preventing human rights.
Yeah, the United States is then put in the same moral and legal box as North Korea and India and anybody else that might in the future seek to have nuclear weapons as states considered to be outlaws and beyond the acceptable pale of the international community. And the hope is that in this process of stigmatization and the creation of rules and norms and procedures in the international system, nuclear weapon states, because they have other interests in the international system other than just having their nuclear weapons, we will be able to find a set of means to make them realize that those benefits of being accepted as a member in good standing in the international community will outweigh those parochial narrow interests of hanging on to their nuclear weapons, and they will decide that it's best to be part of the international community, and the international community doesn't have nuclear weapons, than to remain outside that international community and hang on to that nuclear weapon. So the goal of the ban treaty negotiations is to leverage the idea of an international community based on law and common interest to drive these small handful of states back into the international community because their benefits of belonging and being in good standing are more important than the issue of nuclear weapons. So that's the goal. That's the question there, and we'll move over here.
Just based on your first question and that answer to that question, you kind of brushed over all these details of what would be included in the UN ban treaty, and I was wondering how important you think those details are and what might be the most crucial thing to prevent it from being like the first UN treaty you discussed and be a ban that doesn't apply, or you think that it's more just the social pressure of having a ban and that those details aren't as relevant? And also related to that, how you view the complementary role of more specific things like first strike bills in the U.S. or Iran deals, and how these, in your experience, how much these things play, or if the UN ban is really the, where the focus should be put, I guess.
So let me start with that, and perhaps Tamara can jump in. So what happened in January 1946 wasn't a treaty. It was a call for a plan to abolish nuclear weapons. Right? That the first thing after World War II, you have a United Nations, and the first order of big business is that we need to prevent, we need to ban nuclear weapons. The United States at that time was the only country with nuclear weapons. All we needed to do to ban nuclear weapons for the United States to say, yes, okay, we give them up. And we would not have had a problem. Other countries may in future have tried, given that the United States had used nuclear weapons on Japan, but we would have had to deal with that one issue at a time as the future went on. But they wouldn't have become normal and acceptable for us. So we are in new ground because this is going to be a treaty to ban nuclear weapons, as opposed to a demand for a plan to ban nuclear weapons. The second thing is that, yeah, the details of what will be in the ban are important. And that's what countries are trying to figure out, how to prioritize the different parts of a ban. Because what you want in a ban is, A, to establish the fact that as an international community, we will not accept the existence of nuclear weapons as the basis for a national defense for any country. That this is just fundamentally wrong. So that's principle one. And the exact words have to be negotiated, but that's principle one. The second question is that we will have to grapple with the fact that some countries have nuclear weapons, and some countries are in nuclear-armed alliances, like the European countries that don't have nuclear weapons, but shelter under the American nuclear umbrella and are in the NATO alliance with Britain and France also. So how do we deal with those countries? Right, so that also has to be part of the treaty. And you want to be able to open the door for those countries to join the treaty when they're ready to give up nuclear weapons. And the treaty itself, as I tried to explain, serves as part of the leverage of trying to encourage them to move in that direction. So those are the things that people are actually going to have to wordsmith and figure out how to say this in a way that commands the broadest attention and has the most resilient outcome. Because what you want is a treaty that will last and be durable and not fall apart when it's threatened or challenged. But these specifics like no first use and the Iran deal, these are all important, right? You know, absolutely. I mean, we do want the United States to move away from a policy of using nuclear weapons first in a war. Pakistan has the same policy, right? The United States talks about Pakistan's policy all the time, but not so much about its own. But the question of the Iran deal, dealing with other people's nuclear weapons, has always come easily to the United States, right? And so, you know, that's why part of what we're trying to do is to kind of focus attention back in the United States about the fact that, look, you know, we set this train in motion, right? When Hiroshima was bombed and President Truman was told that the first use of the atomic bomb had taken place, in his diary he wrote, "This is the greatest thing in history." Right? And so we've moved a long way from that, right? But not far enough. But, you know, the goal is that as the Cold War has ended and public attention has moved on to climate change and other kinds of larger concerns, you know, we need to bring focus to this unfinished business that the United States set into play in the world. So you're right, you know, those things also need to be done because you don't want the problem to get worse. But how the problem plays out changes if there is an agreed international treaty to ban nuclear weapons completely. So, go ahead.
I mean, I guess just to underline that it really is about the establishment of the norm. So if you look at the way that, you know, with chemical weapons being banned under the Chemical Weapons Convention, how much it's changed the way that we talk about them on a day-to-day and in the way the media treats it. You know, when there's an attack in Syria, it's, you know, in every article they say, you know, an illegal weapon attack, something that is banned under international humanitarian law, and it's a part of this broader process of stigmatization. Another point, just to add on to what Zia was saying, is that I think what the ban treaty is doing in some ways is it's solidifying a lot of existing mechanisms that are already a part of the sort of regime of you know, agreements in this area. So for example, the nuclear weapon free zones have been around for decades. They encompass their regional agreements, for instance, in South America and Africa and the Pacific and Central Asia, where countries have gotten together and declared like this is a region, you know, free of nuclear weapons, where they have a list that are somewhat similar to what it's looking like the Ban Treaty will be prohibiting in terms of acquisition, stockpiling, transfers, in some cases research. So, you know, those mechanisms have already been around for a long time, but what the Ban Treaty is doing in some ways is sewing this all together and solidifying that norm in I think, a really important way. Maybe I'll leave it there.
So we just have a couple of, before I let you ask your question, we have a couple of minutes left. Is there anybody who hasn't signed the sign-up sheet? Okay, great, so no question.
My question is, you've sort of touched on this a little bit without going into much detail. What are the political processes, in, at least in this country, that are standing in the way of this moving forward? Who is pushing against this and why?
This is a really good question. So one can identify three fundamental pillars of what keeps the nuclear complex, both as a set of strategic ideas and a set of technologies, and budgets and people in play. So one of them is the large shared understanding among the foreign policy and military community of the United States, which dates back to the beginnings of the Cold War, that nuclear weapons are potentially a decisive factor in both political and military confrontation. Right? So as Donald Trump said in the quote that Tamara showed, that, you know, it'd be great to give up nuclear weapons, but as long as other countries have them, we're going to keep them. So if you go back to the beginning, in 1946, there was a study by the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the US military about the military significance of nuclear weapons. And they said, this is really unfortunate that we have nuclear weapons. And it would be better if nobody had nuclear weapons, but as long as anybody's ever going to get them, we have to keep them. So position really hasn't changed from 1946 to 2017 in terms of that particular set of ways of thinking, and that's frequently the justification that's given, that if we don't have them, perhaps we may be at a disadvantage in some unforeseen future situation. Right? This fear of the future is also a fear of the loss of American dominance. Right? Many countries are afraid of the future, right? But they don't arm themselves for a possible future. They just figure out how they'll deal with it when it happens. The United States has a particular notion of the future, which is where it prevails. As Trump says, they have to be top of it. So the American hegemonic project is tied to the American nuclear project across the foreign policy and military establishment. The second element of it is that there is a large number of institutions that actually directly benefit from nuclear weapons, right? Both because of the basing of nuclear weapons and the production facilities. So many people may not know this, but the United States nuclear weapons production complex is actually run and managed by for-profit companies. Corporations make nuclear weapons for money, and they get very rich off doing this. Right? And there are thousands of jobs, lots of congressional support, especially in the areas where the complex is based. And so, for example, out in the Midwest, there are these states where the ballistic missile silos are, where the intercontinental ballistic missile silos, you know, sit in the ground, ready to be launched by Air Force officers. And Bruce was one of these people. You know, he sit in a bunker underground, ready to turn the key and end the world. But there is actually a caucus of senators from the missile states. And I mean, the idea of being a caucus of people who support genocidal weapons, if you send it that way, but they exist, and what they're interested in is making sure that the Air Force bases and the jobs that go with those bases and the funding and the support for roads and infrastructure and everything else continues. Right? And they have power in Congress. And the way that this plays out is that many members of Congress don't have time and attention to give to everything. So they pick issues that are important to their districts, etc. And so if you have nuclear weapons, then you give priority to those things. So you end up being on the key committees that decide these things. So then you end up scratching your own back, so to speak. And the third part of it is this massive ignorance about nuclear weapons that, you know, is spread across the media and across the public. Right? That most media doesn't have expertise in covering nuclear weapons. Most people have never actually had to think about nuclear weapons except when there is a crisis. And what the nuclear freeze movement of the 1980s, etc., taught us is that when you have a crisis, people start to pay attention. Right? But in between crises, people don't pay attention, they worry about other things, and then business goes back to normal. So that's, those are the three pillars that are responsible for this.
Maybe just one thing to add quickly. On this this website, the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, they have actually posted the voting results on the UN resolutions, and they have the yes, no, sort of for every country that participated, including the no votes. And for the no votes, a lot of them provided explanations. So I encourage you, if you're curious about, you know, what stance your country took and the reasons why that they took it, it's there, easy to get to. The U.S. in particular, one of the main arguments they use against the ban is basically saying that it's unverifiable, that there's no way for us to, you know, ensure that nobody is cheating on this agreement. And that's sort of one of the main, you know, pieces of their arguments in opposing it. And I think that exhibits in some ways a lack of understanding about the broader issue and the fact that you're sort of separating the ban from elimination. But also the fact that I think the issue of verifiability is extremely debatable. There's a lot of research going on for how we can actually verify these things, including here at Princeton on the Program in Science and Global Security, and many other research programs are actively working on solutions to that issue. So I think it's a very weak argument, and I'm curious to see, you know, if that collapses, what they'll turn to next. But with that, I think we're out of time. I'm sorry, I don't have a clock, but I see people. Yes, so there is another teach-in on nuclear issues with, again, one that I mentioned, Trump and the Doomsday Machine at 2:15 p.m. Down in the basement. For those of you who might want to, you know, chat more about this and some ideas, we're going to be meeting after that session at around 3, somewhere down in the basement. Again, feel free to stop by for that if you just want to ask more questions or throw some ideas around. Again, this is a day of action, so we want to come out with some semblance of a plan. But again, we're going to be learning and dealing with this on the day to day. So thank you so much for coming and for your time, and hope to see you around this afternoon.